for the presentation. And I was asked to present an overview on the urban history of the city of Istanbul, okay? And I've got half an hour, okay? What a big city, what a short time, so I've got a long okay? So I will try to make this impossible task, I hope, palatable, okay? So I will start by giving to our friends and colleagues facts and figures about what Istanbul is, okay? Then I will tell a brief history, okay? A short history of Istanbul that I have presented in graphics, okay? Like in French they call it bande dessinée, comic strips, okay? So this can be considered as a caricature of our city. So my presentation will be telegraphic. I acknowledge there is I have only 30 minutes to talk about 3,000 years of history. If you look at Google Earth, okay, on Istanbul, the image is quite different than the other cities. Okay, it's a contiguous urban fabric of 5,500 kilometers with practically no interruptions. So this contiguous growth has not been one of the attributes of Istanbul. Okay, the population, rapid population growth, in the 50s when I was born, the population was around 1 million. So we are now in 17 million. And God knows where the city ends. So we are at this. So it's unprecedented European scale. Okay? So this is important because we do have a very important demographic transition. The total fertility is down from 5.6 to nowadays in the western part less than 2, 1.85. So it's about the same as France, okay, in western Turkey. And in this transformation, we have the urban population rising from 25% in the 50s. Now we are in the 70s and 80s%. So we are now experiencing a total reversal of the settlement regime. And Istanbul, of course, has a turbulent history. It was at the end of the 19th century, it was the modernizing capital of a decaying empire. Then, after the declaration of the Republic, it became the stagnating gateway, okay, of the new Republic. It's from Istanbul that the new Republic established its foreign relations. Then, after the Second World War, the city was an overgrown industrial city, very pretty big industrial city. And at that time, the city was called a city of squatters, shared taxis, and street vendors. Okay, so this is the glorious 30s Alla Turca, I would say. I will give you representations of how the city looked like. And nowadays, it's a major global city of the 20th century. It's a hub of airline traffic. As you see, the population do not grow in a decaying city. Okay, so the economy has to be vibrant. Okay. So current processes. Okay. So stunning population growth. So it's the core of an emerging city region. So it's an El Dorado for speculation and for real estate investment. Not only for domestic capital, but for international ventures as well. So there are pressures for urban renewal on the old fabric. Privatization of urban public lands and commons, okay, at the periphery, on the village lands. And privatization of brownfields and infrastructure utilities at the very center. Okay, so these are processes that are unfolding. Okay. And we have now programs that are mostly carried out through the private sector that are geared aiming the systematic traffic and selective renewal of the residential building stock. Okay, so they are selecting the ices or the cherries on the top of the cake. Okay, and we have now the emergence of a new skyline with mixed uses, condominiums, and we have a population of something like 16 million over 2,500 square kilometers. That's for others, just to give you an idea, it's about the population of Holland, concentrated on only 6% of the area of it. And Holland is the is a country where you have the highest density of population in Europe. So I think the problem of congestion is, it's one of the oldest cities in Europe. History goes back to 8,000 years, okay? And with a brand new building stock. So the historical monuments are very few. Okay, it's a dynamic self-organizing city, poorly planned, okay? Generates the bulk of Turkey's GDP, as Lisbon, you have said. Relatively high quality of urban services and higher incomes as compared to the rest of the country. There are mega projects at pharaonic scale, okay? In an airport with 6 runways, okay? A new Bosporus is being planned. The third bridge over the Bosporus. With a bridge, suspension bridge on the Izmit Bay. So these projects are of course unprecedented and pharaonic in scale. So there are already some of them concentrated, new subways, Marmaray passing under the Bosporus, Eurasia Tunnel, they call it, in one of the speediest subway systems under construction in the world, which reduces, these are intelligent trains, which reduces the dispatching distance between trains and increases the per hour capacity to 75,000 per passengers per hour, okay, on each direction. So it's a very up-to-date construction. So this phenomenon is surprisingly understudied. The urban studies, okay, on Istanbul, okay, I cannot tell you that it's not studied, but it's understudied as compared to cities of its size, okay? Potential problems, social and environmental sustainability are at stake, okay, that's no surprise. Transformations, new practices, new boundaries, new divisions, new city walls, okay, are being created. There are no go areas for population. Subtle forms of social cultural segregation. Based on what is called the fabric effect, the new thoroughfares are creating new social divisions. Okay, this is called the new fabric effect on social segregation. There are, of course, lack of channels for public participation. We are now living in a very autonomous ecological footprints do, unfortunately, not rank high in public and planning agenda. Okay, so we are in this transition mode. Okay? So I will, in the rest of my presentation, I will make a presentation how we end up here. Okay, what was the processes that took us here at this particular conjuncture? There are huge investments, but major problems. Okay, so let's start, as you did, with the nightlights in Europe. Okay, if you take the nightlights picture, okay, Istanbul is here. Okay, and okay, over there. So I will try in my presentation how this particular light stay. Came about. Okay, so it is one of the three major gateways to Europe. Okay, if we take Brodel's account, I will show you what are these gateways. It's an overgrown industrial service metropolis and poorly developed fringes at the city region. So we are facing a problem with city region formation, but it's poorly planned. Okay. So these are, according to Brodel, the three major gateways to Europe. Okay, He talks about Marseille, who enables us to go through Alps without going up, okay? Following the Rhone Valley, okay? The other one is the pass Venice-Trieste from the Brenner Pass, the pass to the other side, and then go to the Rhine Valley. And Istanbul, according to Brodel, is a gateway for southeastern Europe because it controls the she controls the access to Danube. Danube is a seaway, a sea thoroughfare or a water thoroughfare that visits all the Balkan countries. Okay. So, what are the advantages, specificities of uniqueness of Istanbul? It has a unique geostrategic location. It's a stronghold, easy to defend. Has been very easy to defend. It has a safe port. That's the reason why it's called Golden Horn. Bosporus. Okay, now disadvantage. Bosporus is an advantage, but it's too wide. And too wide and deep to breach. Very difficult to breach. And too salty to drink. Okay, so it's not a and it limits the connectivity of the metropolitan area. Two sides are given. It has two narrow, it's located on two narrow peninsulas, giving us the scarcity for development. So flat land is a scarcity, it's a hilly topography. Interland is suitable for perishable production, but not suitable for cereals. So the city has to feed itself from long distance trade. No major mountains, and this is very important. Chronic shortage of water. Romans were very aware of this foundation, and the city has one of the most spectacular water supply systems of antiquity. Hundreds of kilometers of aqueducts, canals, dams, and everything. So, and I will show that it has a led to a stable morphology shaped by what the French say urbanisme de ligne, because prior to the pressure system, it was the lines and aqueduct who shaped the macro form of the cities. Okay, it's easy to defend, okay, because we have not only the Bosporus, but it has a current here, and the current is very very strong, I would say. You cannot approach these sea walls because then you are bombarded. And it's impossible to move here, to drop anchor here. So, in a sense, the sea facilitates. And the strongest walls are here. The sea walls are very weak because no one can challenge this the city from the sea. And this is a map of Istanbul in the Byzantine times. Basically, the city was in the historical peninsula on the other side, okay? And there was a very small part on this side, okay? We call it the parasite, the other side, okay? And this was the city. I am not going to make a long history, but to make the long history short, okay, let's make a jump to the early 1900s, okay? Basically, the city is in the same spot with a tiny development here. And it remained, in a sense, between the 15th century and the 20th century on the same macro form, I would say, same spatial matrix. And this, in spite of the economic decline of all East Mediterranean cities, because the rise of the Atlantic economy, okay, with Portuguese, Hot Dutch, and all that, okay, the cities in the Mediterranean enter the phase, they call it the waning of the Mediterranean. Okay. But Istanbul, Venice, Marseille, thanks to their gateway functions, in a sense, defended their population. They couldn't increase their population, but they defended their size. In the first phase of modernization, I would start by the end of the 18th century, early 1800s, okay? The palace, okay, because of political movement, moved to the other side. And after the invention of steamboats, okay, they started to urbanize the Bosporus. Bosporus became a settlement area for the well-off areas. Then came the railroad, okay? And the railroad stopped at the place by the bridge where we are, okay? And after the railroad, they made the second funiculare to connect the Bosporus to the water divide line that is the today's Grand Rue de Pera. This is a divide line which provides the city with the lack of development plan. Okay, so the city can grow on this rich area. So this will be the development of the area. And the at that time, what happens is that the bourgeoisie and elite opted for locations on well-ventilated flanks looking at the Bosporus. And along this ridge line. But the artisans and the petit bourgeois are located on the other side. Okay? So basically, we have this type of social topography. On the historical peninsula, this part was inhabited by the Ottoman elite, whereas the minorities and the Christians lived on the shoreline. So we do have a contrasting position of minorities in space. And this is an example how the different communities, non-Muslim communities, took were established in the peninsula. So this part was the Jewish region. This part was the Greek area, and this part was the Armenian quarters. And this is the same map again: Jewish, Greek, and Armenian. And this was at the end of the 1920s, how the city looked like. We had one power plant, the bulk of the population lived here, and we had a concentration on the other, on Grand Rue de Pera. After the proclamation of the Republic, the city enters the second phase of its development. Okay, this is the between the two wars. So it starts with the declaration of proclamation of republic. Some other historians started with the crisis of 1929, and it ends either in 1946 or 1950s. Okay. So what happens? The city hosts a French planner, Prost, Henri Prost, who prepares a plan to in a sense, to concentrate the city. Because the proclamation of the Republic and the loss of capital city function give a coup de grace to the city's very war-stricken economy. The population of the city declines from 1.2 million in the year 1900 to only 700,000 in 1920s. Okay? So the loss, and then it will take the city some 20 years to reclaim the population loss. So in the first half of the 19th century, Istanbul is a sleeping beauty, okay? No activity. And in that case, the city has too much infrastructure, but very low finances. And Prost, in a sense, concentrates the city, so make the city more efficient. And this was in the 40s, how the city looked like. This is an aerial photograph. The bulk of the urbanized area, modern sector, is concentrated on this ridge line that I have previously shown you. Then we come to the third quarter of the city, 1950s, what we have. This is the era of import substitution, and this is the area where we have before our eyes the emergence of the city of scooters, shared taxis, and street lamps. I have, just to give you an idea, the yellow shade shows the imprint of the urban fabric at the beginning of this period. We will see how this fabric goes on. Of course, we have the emergence of squatter settlement, you say the illegal settlements, okay. And the shown in gray are are these regular housing areas. As you see, there is a space in between. And this space in between is filled with industries. Okay? So in a sense, we are talking about illegal housing, industries, and the regular housing areas. Let me give you how this looks like in space. This is the Levant area, an area. This is the illegal urban traffic. These are the factories. And this is the regular housing, the Zeebrook type. So in a sense, this is very, very unusual to have these three distinctive kinds of urban settlement so close to each other. Okay, so in a sense, I will come back to this picture to explain what has happened to this sandwich. Okay. So in time, the city grows, and the growth of the city is now represented by the position of centers of gravity. So I have shown the position of the center of gravity of the distribution of population in time. So the center of gravity was here in the 60s, in the 70s it moves here, in 80. So in this part, the center of gravity moves like this, in that way. So we are having three sides, and the three sides have sprawls in this three dimensions. Okay. But the resultant of these three decentralization forces always remains at the city center. And these are the decentralization of major factors of production in space. Let's go back to the fourth quarter, what happened in the 80s. Okay, let's start from this image. This was an area that I'm going to take as a reference point. It is transformed to this one. What has happened? These are all factories. Factories are gone, and they are replaced by shopping malls. Okay? The previous illegal fabric is, in a sense, regularized, and the inhabitants were accorded building permits and title deeds. So once they were accorded title deeds, they built in height. Okay, renovated. So we have here the most dense, urban fabric in Istanbul. But we have here all the factories are replaced by new shopping malls. And you see a shade there. This is one of the highest, tallest buildings in Europe. This is it's something like 250 meters of high building. So you see, you can tell it from the shape. Okay, so if we go to the regional scale, these are the areas shown in blue are places that lose their population share. Okay, and shown in blue are districts in which the population share increases. Istanbul is here. You see, at the first ring, there is no increase because of planning controls, and then in the vicinity, we see an increase, the formation of a frail, or let's say, frail formation of a city region. And to recapitulate what I said, in the 1900s, the city had this shape, over there. And then, 1950s, the city grew like this, like as an oil stain. In the 70s, after the construction of the bridge, there had been a population transfer among the two sides. And 1900s, and with the third bridge, now we are, in a sense, totally invading the two peninsulas, when leaving no place for other settlers. Okay, now, if we go back to the social fabric, what has happened in the 2000 after all these processes? I have referred to this fabric effect around the major thoroughfares. So this is the major thoroughfares leading to the second bridge, and this is the major thoroughfare going to the third bridge.
The blue refer to areas where the blue colors are predominant and the yellows are where the white colors. So in a sense, as we go inland from the seashore, the intensity of blue colors increase. So it reflects itself to the social geography as well. And you can have any other indicator for social geography, you end up, you always end up with the same map. This map relates to the household sizes. Shown in dark shades are places where the smallest ones. Okay. Shown in light areas are places where you have the. Okay. So, in a sense, the blue colors are workers with large household sizes. And this is for the schooling profiles. Of course, where the blue colors are overrepresented, the schooling level is not fabulous, okay? It's not impressive. And this is the third factor of social differentiation. And this map reflects itself on any other attributes. Think, for instance, the social or the political geography of areas. These are the results of the 1995 elections. These enclaves where the blue color, okay, well-educated are overrepresented, voted for a different parties than the others. So in a sense, we are talking about a divided city, divided in terms of education, divided in terms of household sizes, divided in terms of political preferences. And if you mix up all these attributes in one synoptic map, we obtain something like this. The white colors, okay, are represented in these shades, okay? The blue and blue color. So in a sense, we are having this type of differentiation. And the old city, the historical city of Istanbul, in a sense, is a model of the metropolitan area. Anything you can find, any color you can find in the metropolitan area is represented at the very city center. So this adds up to the complexity and the differentiation of the lifestyles in the metropolitan area. So what about today? I will end up by saying a couple of words with today's representation. Okay, we have you. So, this will be the last slide I'm going to show. Okay. So this is the website I was talking in the okay. So this website, this map shows two things: the differentiation of land values and the demographic profile. Okay, shown in blue are places. Okay, are places where the average land price is very below the metropolitan average. Okay. So we have six categories, and shown in dark colors are places where the land prices are the highest. Okay? And the shades relate to the demographic profile of these places. So if a place has a dark blue, it means that here we have the lowest land prices, lowest income, okay, proxy, and the, let's say, highest representation of children. Okay? So we can read. So it is possible to, in this lab to go and make a query on each one of these neighborhoods. Select one here and to read the average land value together with the demographic profile observed there. But as you see, this white color, blue color division of the city is clearly visible on the two sides of the urban thoroughfare. Okay.
this is basically what I wanted to tell you in this very short telegraphic resume of this urban history. I will now finish my job by making my map smaller and smaller. Smaller and smaller. And as I make my map smaller and smaller, we will see a larger portion of Europe. And my map becomes smaller. And this is what we have seen at the very beginning of my presentation, the night lights. And then we will see perhaps at the very end the Portuguese city of Lisbon on the other hand.